Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, where we bring evidence, experience, and perspective to make sense of today's leading health challenges. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. This is Josh Sharfstein. Today, patents, patents, patents. Specifically, the more than 300 patent applications filed by its manufacturer on the blockbuster drug Humira. Patent applications that helped to block competition for 7 years. I speak to Tahir Amin, founder and executive director of the Initiative for Medicines, Access, and Knowledge. His organization works to identify problems with our patent system that keep drug prices high. He also has some ideas for solutions. Let's listen. Tahir Amin, thank you so much for joining me on Public Health On Call. I'm very interested in the work that you do trying to get lower drug prices by addressing challenges with the patent system. How are you doing today?
I'm good, thank you, Josh. It's nice to meet you.
Now, sometimes some people can think patent issues around pharmaceuticals are not the most exciting topic. So our job today is to try to explain what these are in plain terms. And maybe picking an example would be helpful. We want to pick a drug that you work on?
Yeah, I think a drug that's been very much in the news is Humira, which is used to treat rheumatoid arthritis and various other conditions. I think that's a good starting place.
Great. Now, Humira is not what we would call a cheap, inexpensive, rarely used drug. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. I know it's very expensive.
How expensive is Humira right now?
I think it can run up to sort of $90,000 a year, maybe slightly less. I don't know the exact figures, to be honest. Probably anywhere between $70,000 to $90,000.
And enough people are taking it that this turns out to be a pretty big spend for insurance companies, for Medicare. Is that right?
Absolutely. It's a huge cost for Medicare and public agencies.
And globally, sales are well over $1 billion.
Oh, yeah. No, this is the best-selling drug ever. This drug was bringing in around $21 billion a year. I think it's a drug that's given AbbVie, who's the proprietor, if you might say, of the drug. It's over $200 billion worth of income.
$200 billion worth of income from one drug.
Sales, yeah.
Now, there's essentially an agreement that we make as a society that people do the investments in research and they reap the benefits, and that's why there are patents. Tell me about the concerns that you have about the patents involved with Humira.
So our concerns, based on the research that we have done, we tracked and mapped all the patents that we could find that are related to Humira. And what we found was what AbbVie had done was once they had the drug approved in 2002 for the first indication, which was rheumatoid arthritis, they filed the majority of their patents after FDA approval. So if we think in terms of the incentive of the patent system is to develop and commercialize a drug, so you get that 20 years of a patent life, and that is used to help you research, develop, and bring it to market. And then whatever time remains, you can commercialize. Well, what AbbVie did was they weren't satisfied with just that 20-year term. They wanted to build a huge wall of patents so that anytime they made a slight variation in terms of formulation or the pen device, or they got another approval for a different indication, because this is a drug that can be used for many different treatments, they were filing patents on each of those little aspects.
So how many patents are we talking about for one medication?
Based on our study, we found 311 patent applications.
For one medication?
For one medication.
Can you give a sense? You've given a couple examples, but what would be like some of the more unusual patent applications or things that they're trying to patent about a medication that they've already developed and commercialized?
Right. So if I may, just give a sort of the early patents would describe, for example, that you could use this large molecule, which is what goes into Humira. You could use it for rheumatoid arthritis. You could use it for ankylosing spondylitis. And that patent explains that, and it claims it sets that claim out there. And then 7 years later, I say, well, I can dose it for those indications at 40 milligrams. And then I get another 20 years of patent. Now, the first patent that I've just described is already running, but I've added on extra years, claiming that I've got this particular formulation. And there were others, such as maybe changing the needle on the pen, so that while there is some utility, some benefit to the patient, that it's not as painful to take. Is that deserved of another 20 years? These are all piled up to kind of create a thicket, which is a wall of patents that companies then have to litigate through if they want to get into the marketplace.
So how are these questions of patents litigated? Who determines whether it's a valid patent? How are they enforced? Are these really keeping people out of the market? Who makes that determination?
So in order to get a patent, AbbVie or any other company, individual, will go to the patent office. They have a document. You describe your invention and you make your specific claims as to what you think needs to be protected. And the patent office will examine and it will either reject it or it will grant it. And once it's granted, then you can enforce that against any competitor who may be making something similar. And that's how the patent system works. That's how it's granted. And then if I'm a drug competitor and I want to come into the market, I have to make sure I'm not infringing that patent. What are the other patents I might have? When you think about it, if you have 311 patent applications, of which 165 were granted for AbbVie, as a competitor, I would have to figure out all these to see which ones I'm infringing, which ones I'm not. And that becomes like you're walking over landmines.
You said something interesting. You said we've found 311. It almost is as if they're not so easy to find. Is that?
Oh, they're definitely not easy to find. And I've spoken with a lot of lawyers who represent companies who have tried to enter the marketplace in terms of these biosimilar drugs, which are the generic versions of biologics. And they believe there are even more patents than what we have found.
So the risk is company looks for patents, finds as many as they can, makes its strategy, tries to challenge patents that may still be outstanding, but then starts to bring medication to market at a much lower price. And all of a sudden the company goes, hold on a second, you missed these 25 patents and we're going to take you to court on that basis.
That's right. And in order to get approval from the FDA for your drug, you have to show that for a biologic, for example, you have to show to the FDA you're not infringing patents. That's what happens with the small molecules, which are non-biologic drugs, which is easier to make. They have these patents that are listed on what the FDA calls its orange book. And in order to get approval, you have to show that you're not infringing any of those patents that the branded company has listed. If you are, then that triggers a litigation. In the biologics, typically if I'm the biosimilar company, I make my application, let's say I've got a competing product, and then the FDA notifies the branded company, and the branded company will say, nope, you're infringing this, this, and this. And then the patent then starts, what they call the patent litigation process. And that can take 4 or 5 years.
When was the first patent for Humira issued?
The first patents on Humira were filed way back in 1989. And this was before AbbVie had acquired it, or Abbott Laboratories back then, because Abbott became AbbVie. So the early research that really cornered off this area of this particular antibody, that was done way back in the late 80s, early 90s. And so the first main patent that really captured the ingredient that goes into Humira was 1996. And so it did expire in 2016.
Got it. And we're pretty far out from that. How long has Humira been on the market in the United States?
2002 was the FDA approval date.
So it's even been 20 years since the approval.
Exactly.
What's the status right now for biosimilar competitors? How long do you think it's going to take before the prices start coming down?
So Amgen just entered the market a few weeks ago with the first biosimilar. So if we take that AbbVie's main patent, the primary patent, expired in 2016, but because of all these other patents that it had sort of laid out, it was able to hold onto the market for an extra 7 years, because there was 11 companies that tried to litigate through this huge morass of patents, and they all just settled. They said, forget about it. And so as a result of the settlement, they said, we'll enter in 2023. So Amgen is the first to enter, and we will see probably several others enter in July this year. Interestingly, in comparison, in Europe, biosimilars entered in 2018 because there weren't as many patents that they had to go through.
And the net increase in costs to the U.S. healthcare system of that difference could be measured in billions of dollars, you think?
There was a New York Times report that just came out a couple of weeks ago. AbbVie made, beyond their main patent expiring, $114 billion because of its patenting strategy, those 7 extra years.
That can support a lot of lawyers.
It certainly does. It's a lawyer's game. There's a quote out there, someone said that patent litigation is a game of kings.
Let me ask you what you would do to change the system to avoid this problem for future medication.
So I know people are concerned that if we disincentivize companies, are we going to get the drug discoveries that we need? I think it's important to note that, at least in my opinion, once you get that first patent, you have a good 20 years protection. Now, the argument is, well, it takes you about 10, 15 years to develop a drug. I think it's closer to 10. So you still have 10 years of commercialization exclusivity. Nobody else can come in unless you give them consent. Running in parallel with that, you get a separate FDA exclusivity. So you're guaranteed, at least if it's a small molecule drug, you're guaranteed at least 7.5 years. If it's a biologic, you're guaranteed 12 years of pure market exclusivity. So this is a separate FDA exclusivity, nothing to do with patents, that the FDA gives you once you get your drug approved.
So in other words, if you're 15 years into your patent, by the time you get biologic approved, you still get another 12 years.
Exactly. You're guaranteeing these things can't be litigated, these FDA exclusivities. People forget this part of the conversation. But what the companies have done is they've kind of almost flipped and saying that we actually want 20 years of patent exclusivity. And that's why they build on all these extra patents, because once the FDA exclusivity ends, they've got all these other patents that push out the protection for as long as they can get away with until litigation decides their fate. Now, I would suggest that, first of all, we need to curb how they get all these extra patents. So we need to raise the bar for what it is to get a patent in the first place. I think what we found over the last 40 years is we've seen an increase in pharmaceutical patenting, largely because we've seen the standards of what it is to get a patent become lower and lower and lower and lower. So just the examples I gave you, like you have a patent that describes that you can use it for certain indications, and then I say, well, I can dose it at 40 milligrams. That shouldn't be happening. I think, secondly, we need to have potentially where you say any patents that are filed after the drug is approved cannot be enforced in litigation. Because what you're doing then is you're essentially using those as a strategy. Now, I can understand, like, if there are new indications that are approved and they have patents related to them, that people say, well, shouldn't those patents count? I think indication patents are actually less about inventing. They're more about clinical trials. And those are very different concepts when you come to think about patenting being something new and non-obvious. You already know the mechanism of action of the drug. So you're going to test it on all these different things and these similar kind of diseases.
Right. Well, what if someone were to say to that point, look, I'm not going to test it for another disease if I know that I can't make any money selling it at the end of the day, that I really need that incentive of some degree of market exclusivity in order to do that study in the first place?
It's a good question. If we consider that factor in a small molecule, when you actually get a new indication, you get 3 years of clinical investigation exclusivity. It might run in parallel to your patent, but you're getting an exclusivity. That means nobody can carve out a label and say, I can use it for that. With a biologic, you're getting your 12 years.
For every indication?
No, you don't get a separate indication. It's blanket 12 years. So what I think is happening is they're not satisfied with that. And so what they're using is they're using the threat of we're not going to do the trials or the testing for the other because we want longer time. But it's the same drug.
What are the chances, you think, of major patent reform happening?
I think the first steps we have to do is get the agencies like the FDA and PTO to get on board and change some of the rules that allow companies to build these thickets of patents. And I think that's happening at the moment. There's the FDA, thanks to President Biden's executive order in 2021 on competition, where he's asked the FDA to write to the PTO to try and address some of these issues that are going on. So I think that's a good starting point. If they can actually do some rulemaking, that might really help at least alleviate some of these pressures. But I think real patent reform, structural patent reform, that's going to take a while because the industry has a lot to lose from that.
Do you think that there's some room for negotiating, for example, changing around the exclusivity that the FDA gives in exchange for more limited ability to do this whole process for patents? For example, for biologics, if they said, look, we want the 3 years clinical investigation exclusivity for our new indications for biologics, because maybe the 12 years have already passed and something else comes up and we want, you know, would you be willing to sit down and say, let's figure out a system that rewards those kinds of investments, but doesn't reward just hiring a whole bunch of lawyers and throwing out 311 patents?
Yeah, I think that would be a place to negotiate. I think you could have what I wouldn't call them patents. I would call them utility rewards, because they're not inventions in the strict. And I think by calling them inventions, we are actually denigrating the patent system. It's a marketing shtick. And having some other reward, like you get 3 years of market exclusivity on top of whatever it is that you've already got, If that's going to be the incentive, fine. But it's got to put that into a patent system, and I think that's the problem we have. The patent system has become this one-size-fits-all sort of solution for everything, and we get away from that.
You know, I have learned a tremendous amount about this, and I thought I knew something when we started. Thank you so much, Tahir Amin, for coming and talking to us.
No, thanks so much, Josh. Appreciate it.
Public Health on Call is a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinale, Philip Porter, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Fernandez and Shian Briscoe. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Thank you for listening.